Hello, today I'm going to talk about some general principles, and I'm going to argue that they apply not just to fist fights, but also to medieval dueling, and right the way through all sorts of conflicts, right up to the Western Front in World War II and beyond, perhaps. And in this video, which is sponsored by our friends at The Great Courses Plus, more of them later, I'm going to present three, yes, three, actually that's not very perspective, maybe I can do better. Yes, three principles which I think can be illustrated to work on these general scales. And the first of these, is the idea of minimum force. So, if you have to fight someone and something is required of you, you should use a certain amount of force, because it's a fight, right? Force is required, but how much should you use? Well, I'm going to argue that if you can, if you've got the skill to, you should use the absolute minimum amount of force that will do the job. So, for example, we're having a fist fight. I don't know why, maybe I spilt your pint or looked at your girlfriend the wrong way, but anyway, we're having a fight. And you throw a punch and it's coming straight at me, straight like that. And if I do nothing, it's just going to biff me straight in the teeth. So what do I do about it? Well, I could, of course, go like that. I could knock your punch miles over that way with a huge amount of effort. I can throw my body weight into it, turn on all my muscles, my chest, my back and shoulders and arms and stiff and hard, knock it out that way. And then I retaliate, biff, like that. Yes, I could do that. Or I could do something much smaller like that. Now, if I do this, my two hands acting in concert have guided your punch that was coming here just to there. So, and notice that I've also moved my head slightly, but just by the minimum amount to make sure that it's not in the way of your punch. So maybe I've in fact blocked your attack by such a tiny amount. Block is the wrong word. I've dealt with your attack by such a tiny amount that I can feel your thumb of your fist just brush my beard as it goes past. Now, if you miss me by 2 yards, I take no damage. If you miss me by a 16th of an inch, I take no damage. The amount of damage I take is the same. But if I'm here, I'm in a very good position to strike back and retaliate. Whereas if I'm all the way over here, I've now got to take all that body weight that was committed that way. I've thrown my whole torso that way, and I've got to bring all those muscles that were acting in that direction to a halt. And I've got to turn everything around and bring my body all the way back before I can retaliate, which takes far longer. Whereas if I just go like that, and my dealing with your attack and counter come one after the other almost immediately. So the ability to counterattack if you deal with an incoming attack using the minimum of force is greater, and that counterattack is in line with my center of body mass. Now, I could, of course, knock you all the way over there, and I could, rather than trying to bring my whole body back for a counterpunch like that, I could just flick like that, but that's not got my body weight behind it, whereas that has. So for a more powerful attack, you want to bring your center to bear on your opponent. So the more force you do that with, the slower you will be in getting your counterattack in. And this would pertain to a sword fight. So for instance, you do an attack like that coming down at me, and for whatever reason, I go bang, and I knock your sword aside with a stupendous amount of force. The tip of your sword goes miles over there. So it's nowhere near me. Unfortunately, the tip of my sword has also gone miles over there. And now we've got a race to get back to strike. And I'm in the same position. I've got so much more committed weight in that direction that it's going to take me quite a long time to come back and strike. And there are several reasons why I might lose that race. The first is that perhaps you didn't come at me like a bull at a gate. Bulls, famously, when fighting matadors, tend to lose. They use a tremendous amount of strength, don't they? A bull is far stronger than a matador, and it can charge really hard. But a skilled matador tends to win against a bull. If you are holding your sword more deftly as you come forwards like that, and I knock your sword with a huge amount of committed weight and effort, bang, over there, you will just be knocked just a little bit, and you won't, because you're not stiff and hard. If you were gripping your sword like fury and stiff of body, if I knocked you hard that way, you would, the whole of you would be knocked aside. But in fact, if you're much more loose and deft, not putting so much effort in, you might only be knocked like that, in which case you've got far less to bring back. And it's worse, because if you're a good swordsman and you're holding your sword more deftly, you can use my force against me. So if you knock my blade that way, rather than you're going like that, which is quite often what stuntmen do in the movies when they're knocked aside by the hero, you could just let the sword go. You're holding the sword not gripped very firmly, but you're just holding the blade by the minimum amount necessary so that you're hanging onto the sword, and the sword goes ping off that way, and you continue using my strength. You continue, the momentum is put into your blade, you bring it round, and then you hit me. So you go like that, and I end up looking rather silly and bifurcated. So using more force than is necessary is a bad idea in a sword fight. And what if you used a feint? What if you, for instance, came down like this, but then stopped? And then I, assuming that you were committed along that line, I fell for your feint, hook, line, and sinker, and I went wah across like that. You could just go stop, see me go past, and go stab, and win. So don't use more force than is necessary. Don't grip your sword harder than is necessary. Don't turn on more muscles. Don't put more body weight than is necessary into a move, because a skilled opponent will use that against you. And you could take this further right up to the grand strategic situation on the front. If, for instance, here's the Western Front in World War II, and the enemy attacks here, well, if you then think, right, let's stop that attack in its tracks, and you put division after division of infantry and all your artillery and tanks and so forth, there's no way they're going to break through the line there. Yes, you've stopped them, but you've stopped them using far more force than was necessary. What if it was a feint attack? What if the main attack is now coming somewhere else along your line? Well, you're now in no position to counter that, are you? You've been suckered. And if the enemy is attacking with tanks, what's the correct gun to use to stop those tanks? Well, I would argue that it's the minimum gun necessary to knock those tanks out. So whether you knock them out at 2,000 yards or 1,000 yards is not really very material. You just have to stop the attack before their tanks overrun your position and rout your troops and break through. And if you put a hole that big in the front of a tank, there the enemy, they're driving a tank, this is good, I like to, oh, there's a hole in my tank. And that means that the enemy can see me, and they've got a gun that can put holes in this tank. I don't want to be in this tank anymore. Open hatch, abandoned. You don't actually have to annihilate the tank, destroy it completely. You just have to put it out of action and get the persuade the crew to abandon it. If you put a hole this big all the way through the tank and out the other side, and then create a massive crater in the ground behind the tank and a huge explosion, well, yes, it may be more photogenic, but you've just stopped the attack. And how could you do that anyway? You'd need an enormous gun to do that. If you've got the smallest anti-tank gun that'll do the job, then you can have more of those anti-tank guns because they're cheaper to produce and easier to transport, and you can put them covering more lines of attack, and they're easier to camouflage. You need far fewer men to crew them, far fewer men to move them, a smaller vehicle to tow them, less fuel to go into that vehicle. Every advantage is with the minimum gun that will do the job. And that's one of the explanations for why in World War II a lot of guns that were used at the front weren't in fact utterly devastating. They were just enough to do the job. Okay, sometimes if the enemy tanks got a bit better, then they weren't quite enough to do the job. But you use the gun that'll do the job and no more, because that's the best for the situation. So there you go. There's our first principle: use of minimum force, and it applies at all scales. The second a principle that I'm going to talk about is staying in contact. Now, let's go back to our fist fight. So you threw that punch, it came straight at me, and I did that, okay? My hands are actually in contact with your arm. This one's up towards your shoulder, this one's about halfway down your forearm, say. I can feel where you are, which is one big advantage. So if you then, from there, try to go over the top and attack me that way, I can feel and move with you and still keep you away from me and keep me safe. So there are two things. I can feel what you're doing, and I can influence your movement. Those are the two big advantages of staying in contact with you. Now, I studied a martial art called Wing Chun, various spellings, including this one and this one. There's a technique called Chi Sao, which is usually translated as sticking hands. I think more literally it's energy arm, but never mind, sticking hands. And we would practice quite a lot movements like this, where you you put your arms onto the opponent, and whatever he does, if he goes low, you go down low with him. If he comes over the top, you bring your arm up and counter that. If he tries to come around the side, you counter that. Whatever he does, you feel what he's doing, stay in contact with him, and you're able by this method to keep yourself safe. And all the time, you're in a position to counterattack. It's a very efficient way of fighting. If I knock you miles over there, I can't influence your movements now. I'm not in contact with you, and I can't feel what you're doing, which means that I have to see it or guess what you're going to do and then react always a little bit more slowly. If I'm in contact with you, I can react immediately because I can feel what you're doing and go with it. Now, there are two really obvious ways to deal with this staying in contact technique. So one is hugely and suddenly to increase the amount of force you're using. So if, for instance, your arm is like that and I've plonked mine on you like that, what you could do is you could push my arm way over to the side, opening up a gap so that you could then punch me. Fine, but if you use that sudden sideways movement to open me up, I can feel what you're doing and immediately slip off. And if you've put loads of force into that and you go over that way, I will be in a position to hit you. And you'll still be traveling that way. I will win the race because you've committed much more of your weight and strength in that direction than I have. So you will have to bring it to the halt. It's the same thing as hitting too hard, same sort of principle. And the other thing you can do is slip off. So again, we're in the same situation. You suddenly decrease the amount of contact and you slip off that way and you can hit me. Except again, you suddenly decrease. I feel, oh, I'm free, biff, and I hit you. Now in a sword fight, if you go into, HEMA people talk about going into the bind. I'm sure there are German and Italian words that mean the same thing. So two swords come together, clash, and rather than springing off each other, as soon as my sword springs off yours, I'm no longer in contact with you, I can't feel what you're doing and I can't influence. But if I swing in and we come to a halt and we've gone into the bind and I stay with you, I stay in contact deliberately with you, then if you take your sword away, I will feel that and I will be able to thrust straight in because I've got the opening. And if you do the same thing as dealing with a man using Wing Chun and you heave me to the side, again I can slip off and counter using your force against you. So going into the bind, staying with the opponent, with spears as well. You quite often will see spearmen staying in contact with each other and they do all sorts of big circular parries, and there's a lot of noise of the two shafts of the spears knocking against each other and sliding around each other rather than just stabbing in space. By the way, this reminds me, I made a video quite recently called, well, originally it was called 6 Reasons to Parry with the Edge. I later, after someone who'd rather misinterpreted it complained, I changed it to 6 Reasons You Might Parry with the Edge. When I was talking about all that, I was holding this sword, and so a lot of people saw, oh, that's the sort of sword that you use in HEMA, so this must be a HEMA instructional video. No, it wasn't a HEMA instructional video, and I didn't mean that it was 6 reasons why anyone who knows anything about sword fighting would only ever parry with the edge, and only the edge under all circumstances, because that is the correct thing to do. It would have been rather a long title. Instead, I had this rather clickbaity title, 6 Reasons to Parry with the Edge, which I was hoping, really, 6 reasons, getting people to click on it. All right, it was 6 reasons why you might end up, despite your best intentions, hitting edge to edge with your opponent. Now, of course, something complication I didn't deal with was that swords wouldn't always meet perfectly at right angles, either edge to edge or edge to flat or flat to flat. In fact, most of the time it's some sort of combination of edge and flat, because you're meeting at some weird angle. Similarly, when I talked about using the strong part of the sword, the width of it, because it's stiffer and stronger, I didn't mean that you should use loads of strength, because you should use, as this video is trying to make clear, you should use the minimum amount of force necessary to do the job. And if I had been making an instructional video for HEMA people, I perhaps would have pointed out that in the medieval treatises, they don't talk about always using the edge. Oh, you must use the edge. They don't talk about that. They just talk about getting at the right angle to your opponent. And if he does this, you head off his attack with your sword held at some angle or other, and some part of your blade will clash against some part of his blade, but it doesn't really matter. It wasn't a concern. It was other things were the concern. So if you really should parry with the edge, then presumably some swordsmaster would have mentioned that in some treatise or other. Instead, no, you it's to do with angles of attack and responses and so forth. It's anyway, sorry, bit of a sidetrack, but I thought I'd get that in. Right, so what was I talking about? Staying in contact. So stay in contact in a sword fight or a spear fight, and the Western Front in World War II, stay in contact with the enemy. If he suddenly slips off, so if the enemy suddenly vacates an area of the front, go forwards. You may think, well, it may be a trap, but you want to stay in contact with the enemy, because then and only then can you influence his movement and know what he's up to. And if he wants to attack at this part of the line, so he pulls out here and moves across, he's opened up a gap here. You could pour through and attack immediately. If you're in contact with him, it's going to take him time to do that. Meanwhile, if you're right up against that line, you could just charge straight through and create a big problem for him immediately. So stay in contact with the enemy. And so it's both in defense and attack. You need momentum. If you're attacking and going forwards, if you don't stay in contact with the enemy, you give him a chance to reinforce, to dig in and so forth. But if you stay in contact and keep pushing him back, he never gets the chance to dig in, because you keep overrunning his positions and it takes a while to dig a foxhole. So staying in contact with the enemy is something that the commanders would want their men on the ground to do. And it can be difficult, but it's important. If you do, leave a load of guys at the front to give the illusion that you're still in contact with the enemy, you could pull away from the rear and move across in stealth and maybe get away with that. But someone has to stay in contact with the enemy to put on the show. So even in World War II, looked at that level of options, of operations, it's still the case that you should stay in contact with the enemy, because only then do you know what he's up to and can you influence him. Right. Now, I said that this video is sponsored, and it is, by the Great Courses Plus. Now, the Great Courses Plus, just in case you don't know, is a massive website with loads of courses, video courses that you can watch. Typically, a lecture is about half an hour, and there might be, say, 24 of them in a series. And they have professors from universities around the world, though I notice largely from Ivy League universities in the USA. And one that caught my eye recently was one by Professor Stephen L. Tuck, and it's about ancient cities. And he starts with, generally discussing the concept of the ancient city, and then he goes logically enough, chronologically through cities. So he talks, for instance, about Katal Hoyuk, or if you want to sound a little bit more authentically Turkish, Çatal Hoyuk. If you're Turkish, you probably can tell I still got it wrong, but that's closer to the original, to the correct Turkish pronunciation. And you could even ask the question, is it really a city? It's certainly a large collection of houses, but it was before the invention of the street. Which is interesting, isn't it? Because you don't think of the street as an invention. Hey, I've just invented the street. You've invented what? Yes, I thought, well, what we could do is we could put gaps in between our houses. It'll make it so much easier for us to get from one building to another. What do you mean? What's wrong with just climbing over the roofs and going through a trap door in the roof? It's worked for generations. What's wrong with that? Well, I just thought it'd be so much easier with a kind of long street. You'd be able to see further, and it's much better for wheelchair access. What's wheelchair access? Oh, good point. That hasn't been invented yet. But fair enough. In the future, it will definitely improve wheelchair access. Hey, he's got a point, actually. The street is an interesting... there's another sideline or something. But there you go. You don't think, do you, of the invention of a street? But with Çatal Hoyuk, they just built more houses immediately next to each other and on top of each other and just sort of expanded into this grand, like, mega building made up of loads of cells. It's a very strange place. Anyway... and he talks about a lot of the usual suspects, like Knossos. Is it a palace complex? Is it some sort of ritual thing? Or is it a proper city? We don't really know. Athens, of course. The Egyptian cities, about which I confess I know very little. Rome and Ostia and Timgad. Timgad's very good in that it's not built on with a modern city. It's in North Africa. I'd love to go there one day. And he talks about the mysterious civilization of the Indus Valley, which is definitely mysterious. It's got a language that no one has translated properly yet, and loads of huge, impressive ruins, but we really know amazingly little about them. But as the man himself says,
Doesn't get any better than that.
And I'd be inclined to agree. Now, I would say that this is a man who's unlikely to distract you from his subject matter by his ties, although occasionally he does really push the boat out, and he wears this spectacular, iridescent beige tie. Oh, yeah, that's beige. Well done, Professor Stephen L. Tuck. So that's one of many courses. It ends with Constantinople, which he regards as the last of the ancient cities. I think he's got a point. Anyway, so that's one of the many courses you can enjoy. And if you go to www.thegreatcoursesplus.com/Lindybeige, then you can find there a landing page. Actually, it's much quicker and easier if you just click on the link in the description below this video. But anyway, you go to a landing page, and this will give you a free offer of 1 month's trial on the site. And if at the end of the month you decided you've seen enough and you don't want to pay money for any more, well, then you can just unsubscribe and you will owe nothing. But clearly, quite a few of you are choosing to subscribe because The Great Courses Plus keeps coming back to me and saying, oh, will you do another sponsored video? Okay. So quite clearly then, the sort of people who watch my channel are the sort of people who will happily subscribe and pay money to watch the courses of The Great Courses Plus. So enough of them. Now on to my third principle. And the third principle is to do with range. I'm going to say that all forms of attack have an ideal range. And when you have two forces meeting each other, it's extremely unlikely that both of those forces have exactly the same ideal range. Now, if I, for instance, I've got a spear and you've got a dagger, you may say that I've got the better range because I've got the longer range, right? But I'm going to say that no, I haven't necessarily got the better range. I've got the longer range. We've got different ideal ranges. So if I've got an 8-foot spear and you're 12 feet away, that's great because with a step and a lunge and a thrust, I can get you and you stand no chance of being able to stab me. So as long as I can keep you at a distance at bay, I've got the better range, right? We're having this fight at my ideal range. But if you can get here, right next to me, then suddenly there's not a lot I can do with an 8-foot spear, and you're going stab, 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 slash, 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 stabby, 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 slash. And you're at your ideal range, and I will stand very little chance. So a fight between a man with a dagger and a man with a spear is one largely of, which is decided by, can the dagger guy get to his ideal range before he's so wounded that the chances of his succeeding are become hopeless. As a man with a spear, of course, I wouldn't want to put all my body weight into one huge thrust that's going to kill you with the first thrust, because if you are able deftly to get past that first huge thrust, you could then run up to me and it's all over very quickly. So I'm likely to do lots of less committed, smaller moves and hope to get maybe a stab in your thigh or something like that to make it very difficult for you to close with me because you're a little bit wounded, and then the blow that kills you will come perhaps a little bit later. Now, that's because the weapons dictated the range there. If I'm a big guy or a small guy, if you're a big guy or a small guy, if I've got a spear and you've got a dagger, that dominates the range, just what we're armed with. But what if it's a fist fight? Do you remember that fight in the playground? Remember, you were 7 years old and there was a huge boy, he must have been like 10 or something, really old, you know? And he was bullying the small kid and he was raining down punches on him like this, and the little kid was just sort of taking it, and he was hoping that the big kid was going to stop, but then you realize he wasn't, so he got angry and he thought, right, I'm not going to put up with this, and he then started punching back in kind like that. He's giving that bully some of his own medicine, and he lost. Why did he lose? Well, because the bully had picked a range that suited him with his much longer arms, and the little kid tried the same mode of attack in retaliation, but because he had shorter arms, here it's their physical bodies that make define the ideal range, he lost. What he should have done is get really, really close to his opponent, because then he can punch down, punch to the gonads, the belly, up to the chin. He's got loads of options, whereas the big kid, when the little kid comes right up to him, he's only really got one action, one angle of attack to punch at. So he becomes at a disadvantage. His punches are less effective because he can't get the sweet spot. He just wants the kid just sort of there to really biff him really hard, and closer in is no good. Or maybe the little kid should run away, grab a stone and throw it. Whatever, pick a range that suits you. So this is the case for two swordsmen. It could be that we have identical swords, but I'm taller than you, so my range is different from your range, or my sword is slightly shorter or longer than yours, and that affects the range. taking it to World War II, it could be that I've got artillery that has a range of 3,000 yards, but your artillery has a range of 5,000 yards. So it's very important, extremely important, that I get to within 3,000 yards of you. Otherwise, you might counter battery fire me. You might find out where my artillery is. When my artillery can't reach your artillery then knocks out my artillery, and my whole army is in trouble. Because in World War II, artillery was hugely important. It caused most of the casualties. So I have an ideal range, and I should get to my ideal range and make sure, if I can possibly manage it, that you never get to your ideal range, which in this case would be between 3,000 and 5,000 yards. So about 4,000 yards would really suit you. I don't want you to be at 4,000 yards from me, so I will do whatever I can to make sure you don't end up at 4,000 yards from me. It does go wrong, of course. In the Battle of Jutland, the British Navy had these stupendous computers. They were about the size of two massive fridges, and they were entirely mechanical, of course. This is before electronic computers. This is World War I. But these were cutting-edge, incredibly sophisticated machines which could do the mind-melting calculations necessary to give the exact angles of elevation and windage to shoot a shell many, many miles at ships that perhaps are even over the horizon. And you're on a moving ship, and the target is a moving thing, and the shell is going to be in the air for a very, very long time, subject to the curvature of the earth and crosswinds and so forth. And they would have to take all these things into account, and they could, because the computers worked, they could land shells accurately on the enemy, which gave them a much longer effective range. But unfortunately, the commander famously just thought, let's be like Nelson, and he steamed straight at the Germans, closing the range very quickly and throwing away this massive advantage. So people get it wrong. But there is an ideal range for you, whether it's a fist fight, whether it's a sword fight, whether it's a naval fight, or an artillery duel. Pick your range that suits you and not your enemy. It's incredibly unlikely that the two ranges that suit you both are identical. Right, so there you go. Three principles. Then that's not comprehensive. There are other principles that could be applied to combat at all levels, but I think three was enough, don't you? Lindybeige!